My name is J.R. Forresteros. I'm the teaching pastor at Catalyst Community Church. And I love the show Undercover Boss. You've probably seen it, right? Heads of organizations, CEOs, or presidents go undercover in their organizations to try to learn what goes on when they're not around. I thought that was an awesome idea, so I decided to crash a worship practice at Catalyst to find out what happens when I'm not in the building. I brought this hat, and then taking off my glasses, boom, meet the newest person to audition for the worship team. I think I'll go by Gerald.
I'm Nathan, so you're our contestant, huh?
Yeah, I heard you guys need a guitar player, and so I'm totally here, first time ever here, and really excited to play.
Wow.
So this is, I think this is Oceans, is that? Is this tuned? And,
Lights,
yeah, do you have like maybe bigger print or anything?
What are you hoping to find out?
What? Maybe I'll just get closer. Okay, that's, yeah, that's, okay, so.
You're going on cover. What are you hoping to find out?
That's a great question.
I'll count this.
Okay.
So one, two, ready, and. Spirit, lead me where my faith without borders and love.
So, what time do I need to be here on Sunday?
So that's really great. You know, we actually have another position that we also need Sunday that might actually work better
okay.
for you, if you don't.
Yeah, sure. No, that's
good.
Yeah.
So this is called Shaker.
Okay.
And so, you know, the same way, like, the guitar is a rhythmic, you know, part of the rhythm section, a rhythmic instrument. So, you know, this. You know, yeah, exactly. There it is. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm feeling it.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. There it is.
Okay.
Yeah. That was made for me.
How much room do I have to improvise? I'm more of like a jazz shaker player. I feel kind of constrained by a lot of the forms of music, you know, as it is. And, so, Mr. Ross, I have something I have to tell you. I'm not really a tryout guitar player. It's JR! It's been me the whole time! I undercover bossed you! Surprise! So, how did you feel when JR revealed his true identity?
Everybody knows him.
So you knew the whole time it was him, and you just went along with it?
Just, you know, does crazy stuff all the time. That's kind of what you have to do. You just let him do what he does and until he tires himself out.
Scream and fight away all of your fears.
Good morning, everyone. My name is JR. I'm the teaching pastor here. And I actually wanted to start this morning with a story that I don't know that I've ever shared like in full detail before, but it's about how I got fired from the first church that I worked at. I was a youth pastor in Columbia, Missouri. That's actually where I met my wife, Amanda. And I had written a blog post critiquing a particular kind of theology. And there was another pastor in town who didn't like the kind of theology that I taught. And so he took my blog post that I'd written, he pulled out some cherry-picked quotes, and then he posted them to a private list server that had a bunch of pastors from all over the state that were a part of it. I was not part of this list server, so from what I understand, they basically got themselves all worked up into a big tizzy. And again, instead of doing what scripture invites us to do, which is come directly to me and talk to me about it, or even reading my entire post in context, they like started a furor, contacted my church and contacted the campus ministry that I worked for, and were just trying to get me in trouble. And it worked. But probably one of the most painful things that's ever happened to me in my ministry career was that my senior pastor, who was the head over me at the church, and then the head of the campus ministry, sat me down in a private closed-door meeting. And they told me that I hadn't done anything wrong, that I obviously nothing I wrote was heretical or there was anything wrong with it. And they said, you know, we want you to understand that we're, you know, we support you here. You didn't do anything wrong. And then publicly they fired me. From both of the organizations, which was devastating. I mean, it would have been devastating in any case, right? But what made it even worse was all of this happened in like February and March of 2009, and my wedding was scheduled for July of 2009. And so, needless to say, the plans that my then fiance and I had were completely upended. We had this clear vision for what our first few years of marriage were going to look like, with me being in ministry at the church and the campus ministry. She was also working at the campus ministry, and you know, even though her contract was up in June, she was thinking about renewing it and, you know, and continuing to work there. And then, you know, we had a big community of friends and people that had become like found family for us that we had cultivated. And so that was our kind of our plan A, until I got fired, and then everything got upended. And we had to figure out what to do next. And it was hard not to feel a deep sense of betrayal, wondering if God had called me to ministry, why was God letting this happen, right? Why was this being done? Now, I want to pause in my story there, because, you know, obviously it didn't drive me out of ministry or anything like that. But I want to ask if you can think of times in your life when you've experienced that sort of fallout. Again, maybe it was a relationship that you thought was going to last forever that came to an end. Or maybe there was some kind of a job situation that you had that was a similar kind of a betrayal. There's something in your mind that you had a plan A, you had a way that things were supposed to go, and then something happened. Maybe it was a mistake that you made, or maybe it was something that was done to you from outside circumstances that caused you to no longer be able to follow that plan A. I bring that up because I think it's really, really a common thing, and it's natural for us to wonder, when plan A fails, where God is in it. How come, if we're being faithful, if we're trying to honor God and follow God's will and be faithful to how God has called us, why do these kinds of bad things happen to us? I think that's a really normal and natural question to ask. And it's one that I want us to ask today in light of the changes that are going on in our church. Because again, I think any of you who have been around very long know that these are not changes that we sought out, but there's some of them are, in some ways, were sort of thrust upon us. And so I want to ask, what does faithfulness look like when plan A fails? And what does faithfulness look like when we're on plan B, or maybe plan C, or maybe plan Z? Right? And what we're going to see today is that no matter what our circumstances, God is faithful to work in even the worst situations to bring good, and to be faithful to us, and to continue to invite us to accomplish the things that God has called us to. So we're going to begin this morning by singing together. I'm going to hand it over to
Chanel
and to the worship team, and I'm going to invite you to stand with me as we begin singing together, and we celebrate this God who is so faithful that we can trust God even when our plans fall through. Would you join me?
Today we are here kind of live from a slightly different location. We're going to sing some praise songs together, and I thought that I should get a little bit of help. So I asked a few people to come along and help us sing and dance together this morning. So who have I got here with me?
Stella, AJ, Evie.
Ooh. Yeah, I don't think y'all are ready for this. So we're going to go ahead and sing some songs together. Yeah? You guys ready? Okay. a little bit later on in our gathering, we're going to take communion together. So you can go ahead, grab crackers or juice, or what do you guys usually have for?
Cranberry juice.
That's a good one.
Or
grape juice. Or grape juice. Or water.
And we get some bread or crackers.
Or bread or crackers.
Yeah, we'll get those.
Sour bread sometimes. So whatever you have handy, go ahead and grab that for later on in our gathering, and we're going to take communion together. Right now, we're going to go ahead and sing a song, and we're going to sing a new song, it's kind of old because it's about 20 years old, but new to y'all, I'm sure. And so we're going to, you guys ready to learn a song?
Yes!
Yeah? Yeah?
Yes.
Okay, they're ready to learn a song. So how this song will work is for the verse, for the first part of the song, I'm going to sing a line, and then you're going to sing that line right back.
Yeah.
You get it? Yeah?
Kinda
yeah?
Like
kind of like an echo. Hey.
Get it.
He's got it. He's got it. Kind of like an echo. So, first, I'm just going to sing the line, and then you guys sing it back to me. You ready to practice?
Yes.
Ready? Yeah? Okay. All right, so it goes like this. So, I will worship.
I will worship.
With all of my heart.
With all of my heart.
I will praise you.
I will praise you.
With all of my strength.
With all of my strength.
Nice. I will seek you.
I will seek you.
All of my days. I will follow.
I will follow.
All of your ways.
All of your
ways. Nice. Y'all ready to do it for real?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay. Y'all ready to do it for real?
Yes.
Well, okay. Well, here's hoping. I will worship.
I will worship.
With all of my heart. I will praise you.
I will praise you.
With all of my strength.
With all of my strength.
I will seek you.
I will seek you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will follow.
I will follow.
All of your ways. Let's do that one more time. Say, I will worship.
With all of my heart.
I will praise you.
I will praise you.
With all of my strength.
With all of my strength.
I will seek you.
I will seek you.
All of my days.
With all of my days.
I will follow.
I will follow.
All of your ways. All right, we're going to sing this together. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone, I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. Yeah! Let's sing I Will Worship again. Say, I will worship.
With all of my heart.
I will praise you.
With all of my strength.
I will seek you.
All of my
days. I will follow. All of your ways. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone, I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
Woo!
All right, we're going to do one more verse. It says, I will bow down. And hail you as King.
I will serve you.
Give you everything.
I will lift up
my eyes to your throne.
I will trust you.
Trust you alone.
I will give you all my worship.
I will give you all my praise.
You alone, I long to worship.
You alone, I long to.
I will give you all my worship.
I will give you all my praise.
You alone, I long to worship.
You alone, I long to praise.
Woo! Yeah.
Woo-hoo!
All right.
That was good.
We're going to sing another song. This time we're going to get up and move around a little bit. We're going to We're going to apparently do the shimmy shimmy. And this one, you should all know. Giver every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your worth. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. I'm alive. I'm alive because I'm alive in you. And it's all because, and it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. And it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me, and raises dead men's life. Yeah. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. You gonna sing that again?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right, giver. Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity. Hey, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your worth. King over all the universe, to you be the glory. And I'm alive, and I'm alive, because I'm alive in you. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. And it's all because of Jesus Christ. It covers me and raised this dead man's eye. And it's all because of Jesus. Hey, every sunrise sings your grace. The universe cries out your praise. Singing freedom all my days. Now that I'm alive. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. And it's all because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It covers me and raises dead men's life. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive.
Yeah. Woo! Woo!
Thank y'all. All right, we're gonna pray. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your son to die for us. Thank you for being so good to us and loving us so much. We ask that you would just continue to bless us. And we ask all this in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
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 As we're continuing to worship, I wanted to make sure that all of you have had a chance to see the signups that we're doing to help build out our plan for our new congregational model. This is something that affects all of us, and so we wanted everyone to have an opportunity to weigh in, and the best way you can do that is by signing up to be a part of some of the decision-making groups. And so hopefully you saw it in the Facebook group or on our email list or in the Discord earlier this week. If not, or if you did but you just forgot to sign up, you can see the link. It's appearing now. And it's also in the description for the YouTube video, so you can do there if you're watching with us live. But yeah, please make sure you get a chance to do that. We would love to have your input wherever you're feeling passionate. I've already heard several of you expressing interest in some very specific parts of what we're doing, which makes me so excited. This is a conversation I want us all to be having together. I want this to be something that's exciting. I'm excited about it. And so this is the best way for you to get involved in that and make sure that your very good thoughts and ideas are contributing to what's coming next for us. Now, this is the time when we pass peace together. So the first thing I want to do is dismiss the kids to head back to the lab. Thank you, kids, for being in here with us. Thank you, Miss Vanessa, for leading our children. And as they're going, we're going to pass peace. And so this is something that we do every week here at Catalyst because we believe that peace comes into the world through God by God sending us as peacemakers. And so we practice that here in worship by exchanging words of peace and then signs of peace, which if you're like me, virtual today, then that can be finding a funny GIF or snapping a selfie or something like that. If you're in the building, that can be anything from a hug to a nice socially distanced head nod, whatever you're comfortable with. But again, we're going to spend a couple of minutes doing this together as a way of remembering that God brings us together so that God can send us out to make peace into the world. So I'll begin us all by saying, peace be with all of you. Last week, we began a series called New Leaf, and I know that that feels like a spring series, but we don't really have seasons in Texas, which is where I am, and so I thought it would be fine. Plus, we are on the cusp of a major change in our church congregation. We're moving away from the model that's been centered on a particular location in a building and moving to something that's decentralized, and it's a big change, and so I thought it would be helpful for us as we begin to navigate this change for us to, as a congregation, look at some of the people in the Bible who experienced big changes to see how they responded so that we can discern what faithfulness looks like in the midst of major change. We began last week by looking at Abram. And we saw that basically when Abram knew nothing and had everything to lose, he still stepped out in faith and followed a God he did not know very well into an uncertain future. And despite everything else that happened afterwards with Abram's story, the reason he's a model of faith is because of that choice that he made. Today, we're going to move a little bit forward in biblical history and again look at what happens when our plans fall through, right? What happens when the plan A that we made in life fails, either again because of our own choices or because of the choices that other people make? What happens when we're in the midst of plan B? How can we see God as faithful? And more importantly, what does faithfulness for us look like? So if you have a Bible, turn with me to Genesis chapter 37. Today we're going to hang out with Joseph, who is Abram's great-great-grandson. Joseph is the son of Jacob, and Joseph is the youngest at this point in the story of 11 brothers, and he had a bunch of sisters too. But he's the youngest boy. Eventually, he will have another younger brother named Benjamin. But for now, Joseph is the youngest, which essentially means culturally he was completely unimportant. You've probably heard often that in the scriptures, in the times of the Bible, the eldest was the most important son. They got two-thirds of the inheritance, and the rest of the inheritance was divided among all of the rest of the siblings and all of that. So you can imagine Joseph being number 11, not super important in terms of the cultural view. Of course, in the scriptures, he ends up being very important. The other thing you need to know about Joseph is that he kind of had a superpower. He had the ability to understand and interpret dreams. In the ancient world, it was often thought that dreams were a way of the gods communicating to humanity, and Joseph had the ability to read those dreams and to tell people what God was telling them through those dreams. And so kind of early on when we meet Joseph, this is exactly what happens. His father, Jacob, is a shepherd. He has massive, massive amount of flocks. And so his elder brothers have the job of taking care of these various flocks of their father's sheep. Joseph being the youngest and the favorite, I think I forgot to mention that, he was daddy's favorite boy, didn't have to do as much work, which, as you can imagine, already caused a lot of resentment. And I guess, by the way, I should pause and say, full disclosure, I am an eldest brother, and so I don't want anything I'm saying today to come across as blind youngest sibling hatred, okay? We understand that not all youngest siblings are brats, right? Not all of them are spoiled. Most of them, sure, but not all of them, right? And so we shouldn't take anything I'm saying about Joseph as emblematic or representative of all youngest siblings by any means. That's specifically for Nathan. So there you go, bud. Anyway, back to the scriptures. Joseph in Genesis chapter 37 has two different dreams where he understands very clearly that God's will is that one day Joseph will be more powerful than everyone else in his family. And that in fact, he will rule over them and they will all bow down to him. Now, being young and headstrong, Joseph does what not all, but maybe most youngest siblings would do when given this information. He goes and tells his siblings and his father right away. And as you might imagine, this does not go over well. So what I want to read for you is just a little bit of how Joseph's father and his brothers respond to this information that Joseph has received, which is again, that God has promised him that one day he will rule over his entire family. So this is beginning in verse 10. This time, Joseph told the dream to his father as well as to his brothers, but his father scolded him. "What kind of dream is that?" he asked. "Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" But while his brothers were jealous of Joseph, his father wondered what the dreams meant. So there you can already hear, even in his father Jacob's language, right? That the idea that an 11th brother would rule over the rest of the family is not only a little silly, but actually even offensive, right? It just cuts so far against the grain of what the cultural expectations were that they found it offensive. His brothers were so incensed, this was kind of the last straw for them. And so they actually faked his death and sold him into slavery. And this is the beginning of sort of a roller coaster that Joseph goes on over the course of the rest of his life. We're not going to read all of it because it's probably almost 10 chapters of scripture. And I want you to spend some time in that over the next week. But I want to kind of give you the high and the low lights of what happens to Joseph. So obviously, his brothers faking his death and selling him into slavery is a low light. He ends up sold to an Egyptian man named Potiphar, and Joseph is so good at what he does that he quickly ends up as the head slave in Potiphar's household, which actually was a pretty prestigious position. In the ancient world, the way slavery worked there was very different from the American conception of slavery that we have. The head slave of a powerful person often had a lot more power, social capital, than free people who were of lower status. So Joseph being the head of Potiphar's house was actually a pretty good position for him considering where he had started out. However, before too long, Potiphar's wife falsely accuses Joseph of assault, and Potiphar has Joseph thrown in jail. So again, we're back down into the depths, right? While Joseph is in jail, there are two men who are part of Pharaoh's court who are also jailed. They both have dreams, and Joseph interprets their dreams accurately. When one of them gets freed and restored to his position beside Pharaoh, he promises Joseph that he will remember Joseph to Pharaoh, that he will essentially speak well of Joseph, advocate for Joseph on his behalf. So you can imagine Joseph thinking, okay, I'm going to be free, right? Problem is, it doesn't happen. The guy completely forgets once he has his freedom about the people that were with him at the bottom. That is, until 5 years go by, and Pharaoh has a dream, a very disturbing dream, that none of his court can interpret for him. It's at that point that his servant says, "Oh, you need a dream interpreted? I know a guy." Pharaoh sends for Joseph. Joseph comes before Pharaoh, and it turns out that God had sent Pharaoh a warning that Egypt was about to enjoy 7 years of bountiful harvests. They were going to have a bumper economy. Everything was going to be great. But then after that, we're going to follow 7 years of intense famine. And so Joseph warned Pharaoh of this, and he said, "No one asked me, but if I were Pharaoh, I would spend these next 7 years of plenty preparing for the 7 years without." Pharaoh thinks this is a great idea, so he ends up elevating Joseph to second in command over all of Egypt. Now, that is an amazing life, but think about all of the times that Joseph was at rock bottom, the time that he was thrown in a pit and sold into slavery, the time that he was falsely accused of assault and imprisoned, the time that he was forgotten for 5 years. These are long stretches of time when Joseph had done nothing wrong to deserve such harsh treatment. In fact, Genesis tells us again and again how faithful Joseph was. And yet, despite his faithfulness to God, mostly because of other people's actions or inactions, he continued to suffer. It was this incredible roller coaster that makes Joseph's faithfulness through the process all the more amazing. Now, as I think about Catalyst's history, I think about our own roller coaster that we've been on. We've had a couple of different staff people who were really influential in our congregation, who have done things that have really hurt us, things that a lot of us who were around in those times were really, really traumatized by. We also, as a church, made a commitment to really lean into our calling to be a church for all people, to lean into the call to be a diverse church and to do the real work of diversity, not just the sort of token kind of stuff that we see a lot of times in our culture. But we chose to do that at a time when America was becoming more and more and more divided. And so we saw those fault lines happening even in our own congregation, even as we were trying to be faithful to where we thought God was calling us to go next. And then, of course, we had a global pandemic that no one could have predicted, that was terrible for all of us. Again and again and again, we tried to serve our community and the world around us. We kept finding different partnerships from everything we were trying to do with our land, you know, making a soccer field, working with Life Message on it, doing something with Habitat for Humanity, to even the Global Missions Projects partners we tried to form partnerships with. And again and again and again, our partners did not come through with us. And so again and again and again, we were stymied in the ways that we really felt God was trying to lead us to serve and to love the way God loves and serves the world. Often through no action of our own, we were unable to do the things that we felt God was calling us to do. And I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one that over the last decade has wondered, am I going crazy here? I mean, we are trying to be faithful to God. We are trying to be a church for people who are far from God, people who are not interested in church. And yet again and again and again, it feels like we've hit obstacle after obstacle after obstacle. So I feel a lot of resonance for Joseph's story. And if I'm being honest, I feel really inspired by him because there have been plenty of times that I've wanted to throw in the towel. I'm sure the same is true for you as well. And yet what we see from Joseph is a commitment to be faithful to God, even when he doesn't understand what God is up to, even when he doesn't understand where God is, even when he doesn't understand how God could have let him descend to the places that he ended up. And so I want to hand it back over to Chanel and the worship team. And I want to invite you to sing with me again. But I want you to feel free to bring these doubts and anxieties and questions that you have with you. Maybe even this sense of betrayal or this sense of feeling like you don't know where God is. These are experiences that belong in worship. And Joseph shows us that they can be a part of faithfulness too. That, that just having those experiences or having those feelings doesn't alienate us from God. What matters is what we choose. And Joseph shows us what it looks like to choose faithfulness. So would you stand with me again and let's sing again together as we continue to worship. We'll be right back.
every morning.
So remember that I said that Joseph's story is a story of faithfulness. And what we see at the end of his story is exactly how God is faithful to Joseph. So I told you that he ends up as the second most powerful person in Egypt, second only to Pharaoh himself. And just like Joseph warned, they had 7 years of plenty where Joseph was the administrator, making sure that they saved food and made it, preserved it. And then they had a massive famine that struck the entire region. And so about 2 years into that famine, guess who showed up in Egypt needing food? Joseph's brothers. They'd been sent there by their father because the famine had struck them and they needed food. And of course, when they appear before Joseph, they have no idea who he is because, you know, the last time they saw him, he was a bratty little kid that they tossed in a pit, sold into slavery. And so the guy before them in full Pharaoh makeup garb certainly did not remind them of their long-lost little brother. Joseph immediately recognized them, though, and he was in a big predicament. He needed to know if his brothers had really changed or not. Well, I guess he didn't need to know, but you could tell that he wanted to reconcile with them. But he couldn't do that until he found out whether they had changed. And so, again, we don't have time to get into it, and it's a little bit silly, but he does these elaborate, like, pranks, sort of, to determine whether or not his brothers have changed, and he's able to determine that, in fact, they have. They've grown up. They've become better men than they were, and they genuinely regret what they had done to their brother Joseph. And so it's with that information in mind that Joseph finally reveals his true identity to his brothers. And I want to read that with you in Genesis chapter 45, because it's really a beautiful, powerful moment. So Genesis tells us that Joseph could stand it no longer. There were many people in the room, and you can imagine, right, all of the, like, his court functionaries and all that, and he throws them all out. He says, "Out, all of you." So he was alone with his brothers. And I mean, again, can you imagine what's about to happen here? This guy has been messing with you since you got here. He's the second most powerful person in the world. He literally controls the food you need for with whether your family lives or dies. And now he's suddenly like kind of flown into a rage and thrown everyone out except for you and your brothers. And you've got to be wondering what's going on, right? He was alone with his brothers when he told them who he was. Then he broke down and wept so loudly the Egyptians could hear him, and word of it quickly carried to Pharaoh's palace. "I am Joseph," he said to his brothers. "Is my father still alive?" But his brothers were speechless. They were stunned to realize that Joseph was standing there in front of them. Of course they were, right? But there's a couple of things going on in this passage I think are really provocative, beyond the brothers' fear, beyond the brothers realizing that this guy who's been acting like pretty unstable is actually the brother that the last time they saw him was when they had just sold him into slavery, right? When he says, "I am Joseph," that is a formulation that is used by God to reveal God's own name to people. We're going to see that next week when we look at Moses, right? But that "I am who I am," if you're familiar with that formulation. So this is a moment of vulnerability and self-disclosure that we often see mirrored in God. And then last week, I mentioned what theologian Walter Brueggemann called a gospeling moment, right? When dead things come back to life. So we saw Abraham trusting that God could bring life even though he had never had any children. This is another moment like that because these brothers have thought that their brother is gone forever, right? Dead or as good as dead. They've thought that any sort of chance of reconciliation and restoration has been gone forever. And yet now in this moment, new possibilities emerge because the one who was dead has been found alive. It's a good newsing kind of a moment. And so to their stunned silence, to their fear, to their anxiety, Joseph says, "Please come closer." So they came closer. And he said again, "I am Joseph, your brother whom you sold to slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives." I love this. I love that Joseph doesn't just ignore the things that has happened. He doesn't say, water under the bridge, no harm, no foul, because there was a good bit of harm, right? And Joseph has every right to have been hurt, to have been angry. And yet what Joseph is able to do is stand back and look at the larger picture and say, look, what you did, you intended to harm me, right? Now, yes, you were young. Yes, you did it out of petty jealousy. Yes, you feel sorry now and you've worked your life to make amends. But what you did to harm me. He names it. He's honest about it. And then he says, but God was not content to let you harm me. God used your sinful choices to work good, not just for me and not just for you, but for the whole world. That too is a gospeling statement, right? What we intend for evil, God turns into good. It is a powerful statement about God's refusal to let our sinful choices or the sinful choices of other people derail God's saving mission. God had made a promise to Abram that he was not going to let fail, even if Abram's descendants made the wrong choice. No matter what was going to happen, God was going to work it so that those who were faithful to God would be co-laborers in the promises that God was still keeping through Joseph's day and into the lives of his descendants, all the way to Jesus and all the way down to us. Now, friends, as we look to the future of Catalyst, I know we have a lot of questions. And I know that none of us probably intended for this stage in our journey. I don't know what you thought when you decided you want to become a part of a church that was primarily concerned with reaching out to people who don't like church. Maybe you imagined that one day we were going to have a, you know, a big building with lots of facilities and you know, places where people would come and use it in the community, or like some kind of community center hub. Or I don't know what you planned. I know for many of you who are virtual, you probably never intended to come to Catalyst in the first place, right? For many of you, we were sort of a stopgap or a temporary measure because you were looking for somewhere safe to worship when the places that you had called your faith home had become unsafe. And yet, all of us have come to this place because God is doing something new in our world. because God has never allowed the unfaithful choices of even people who claim God's name to ruin God's mission. And God still cares about people who are far from God's love. God still calls us as a people to be a people about sharing God's love with those people. And more and more and more, that does not happen in a church building. More and more and more, those connections have to come outside, out there, in spaces other than the traditional spaces we're used to. And so here we are on Plan B, moving ahead into an uncertain future. I seriously doubt we're finished with Lowe's. I seriously doubt that we're getting off the roller coaster. It's more like we're just, you know, moving on to the next one that probably has some even crazier bumps ahead. But I know that the same God who was faithful to Joseph will continue to be faithful to us, because God is good, because God loves us, and more importantly, God loves the world that we're called to serve. And so as we approach this communion table today, I hope you can feel that God. I hope you can feel their presence with us. I hope you can feel that invitation to this table, to be a part of this community, to be a part of discerning together what's coming next for us. You don't have to be a member of Catalyst to receive communion with us. You just have to be someone who's willing to say yes to God and follow that wherever it leads, to trust that God is faithful even in the ups and downs. And it's helpful to remember that we share this meal with Jesus the night before he went to the cross for us. Before we receive communion together, I'm going to lead us in a prayer of examine. I'm going to ask a few questions, and then I'm going to invite you to pray with me together. And then after that, we will receive these elements together. So here's the first question I want you to consider today. Think about the week that's brought you here. Or maybe think about the weeks or the months that have been behind us. What are some times that you've experienced God's presence closely? Now, what are some times that you could name where you've experienced fear or anxiety or betrayal or anger? Now think about the days and the weeks that are ahead of us. What are some times that you might experience some anger or some fear or some anxiety as we move into this new model, as we move into something different? And finally, what does it look like for you to say yes to God and to be faithful to God in the days ahead of us? Let's pray together. God, you have gathered us today that we might be really honest and vulnerable in confessing that we live lives where things don't always go the way we thought they would. Sometimes it's because of choices we make. Often it's because of choices other people make. And in those times, it's easy for us to feel angry, to feel frustrated, to feel anxious, to feel afraid. It's easy for us to feel a sense of betrayal, even that you have betrayed us. We wonder how you could have let such things happen to us. Thank you for the story of your servant Joseph, who, even in the midst of those questions and those feelings that he experienced, was able to say, I believe God is working. I believe God is not done with us. I believe that the worst that humans can do is not stronger than the best God can do. Thank you for the way you revealed that to Joseph and to his brothers in a way that was able to bind their family back together, to restore what was broken. As we look ahead, we have our own fears and anxieties. We have our own questions. Help us to ask those. Help us to express those. Help us to be honest about them, even as we choose faithfulness. We bring them with us to the table today. Offer them at your feet. In return, we receive these elements, and we pray that they would be a spiritual food, that as we receive them, we might receive the grace that we need to trust you. Thank you for welcoming us. Thank you for marking us as your children. And thank you for bringing life from death in every way, big and small. We offer these prayers now, and we approach your table in the name of your son, Jesus. The night Jesus was betrayed, this is the meal that he shared with his followers. And it was during that meal that he took bread and broke it. He said, this is my body broken for you. Take it and eat it. When the meal was finished, he gave them a cup of wine. He said, this is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and drink it. And so now we too eat and drink. And as we do, we remember Jesus' death until he returns.
Now and
stand high and surrender. I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. So here I stand high and surrender. I need holds me now.
Catalyst, again, I want to thank all of you who are continuing to give to the congregation. Again, we really, especially right now as we're transitioning, really are relying on your faithfulness in that area. So thank you for that. If that's not something that you've been doing, you want to be a part of that, you know, our secure giving links are in the YouTube description, and you can find that information in the building as well on how to get it, how to do that. But again, we appreciate that a lot. Now, as you're going, I would love for you to spend some time with Joseph's story this week, because there is really so much more than we were able to cover. So, you know, it's from Genesis 37 to 45. You can take some time to read that. Bits of it all or all together, however you want to do it. But I think it would be really helpful as we're navigating these changes to see exactly how much Joseph went through and what faithfulness looked like for him over decades of ups and downs. It really, really is inspiring. As you're going now, I'd like to dismiss us with a blessing, so I invite you to stand with me. I want to say, Catalyst, we are often caught off guard when our plans fall through. But we serve one who never caught off guard and who never lets the worst things that humans can do upset the plans that God has made. So would you go trusting that God is at work in every one of our circumstances, bringing about good, making us into the church that our culture needs right now. Go in faith, trusting that this God who began this good work in us will continue to complete it. Go in the grace and peace of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we will see you next week.